Hey, how's it going, guys? Today I wanted to talk about a few myths I've heard when I was building a PC for the first time that are still around to this day. Number 1. You need an anti-static wrist strap. The one thing I got so worried about when I was building for the first time was accidentally short-circuiting or damaging a part by touching it. I was told to prevent any issues, I would have to ground myself, and in order to do that, I would have to get an anti-static wrist strap to prevent from damaging my components, and it was the easiest way. Sure, it's easy, but you actually don't need an anti-static wrist strap to ground yourself, and it's still really easy to do. So all you really need to do is install your power supply, aka PSU, onto your case, and then plug it into a good working wall outlet. Make sure it's turned off. Now, your case is grounded, and you can go ahead and touch the metal part of your PSU or case. It's that simple. I did make a quick demonstration video on how it's done. Link will be down below in the description if you want to watch it. Number 2. Poor cable management can overheat your PC. You might hear someone mention about having poor cable management can affect your cooling performance, like it can cause your CPU, GPU, or another component to overheat. This might be possible under extreme circumstances, like for instance, if you have all the air inputs blocked off in your case where air can't flow through, then your case would start to heat up. But you really won't have any problem like that for the most part. Good cable management isn't completely worthless, as it can also help with dust prevention over time, and it makes your case look organized. Having poor cable management would just make your rig look messy when you open it up, and at most, it would probably get in the way when you're upgrading a part. I have poor cable management in my rig, and I still haven't had a problem to this day. I'll have a link down below on a video by Linus Tech Tips showing under what excruciating circumstances would having bad cable management impact the cooling performance. Number 3. More RAM equals better performance. Having more RAM in your PC will not always boost your performance in games. That is, if you already have 8 gigs of RAM or more. 4 gigabytes is not enough these days for many games to run smoothly in 1080p, and in that regard, more RAM could increase your performance in games and multitasking. 8 gigabytes has been the standard for a while, and many games do still require just 8 gigs of RAM, but I believe that we're coming to the point where 16 will become the standard, maybe in the next 2 years or so. At the time of this video, the only game I know of that takes advantage of 16 gigs of RAM is Battlefield 1. It would be best to monitor how much RAM your computer is actually using while gaming or doing something else to figure out whether it's necessary for an upgrade or not. Number 4. More cores is better. When I saw the AMD FX9370 octa-core processor was around the same price and had more cores than the Intel's i5-4690K quad-core processor, I thought to myself, this must be too good to be true, and I was right. I thought the octa-core would run faster than a quad-core, but not in this case. When I saw the benchmarks and a few videos, I was disappointed with AMD, so I ended up going with Intel. Now I don't want to get too deep into technicalities and specifications, so think of the AMD's 8 processors to Intel's 4 cores as quantity over quality. This is just one example of more cores not equating to better performance. Number 5. Higher clock speed equals better performance. If we look at the previous example where the Intel i5 was clocked at 3.5 GHz while the AMD FX was at 4.4 GHz, the i5 still performed better at a lower clock speed. More gigahertz doesn't always mean better performance because they're not all created equally. Clock speeds would be more comparable between chipsets from the same family, like if you're looking at a Haswell line of Intel i5s, a 3.4 GHz would be faster than one running at 2.6 GHz by 30%. Number 6. It's cheaper than buying a console. Now I know what you're thinking, this isn't a myth, but I'm going to talk about the misconception of this. Let's say it costs $400 for a console and you buy two AAA titles, where that would come out to be $550 if we round up and include tax. Some people believe that you can build a pretty sweet rig and have your cost to be around $400 with $150 left over, but for first-time builders, there's more costs to keep in mind in order to make a complete setup. Besides the cost of your rig, you'll also have to consider getting a desk, chair, monitor, and speakers, to name a few, which will usually end up costing more than what you may have originally thought, assuming that you're planning on buying new parts. When I was building for the first time, I expected to have a budget of $700 for my build, and I ended up paying somewhere around $900. The thing is that in the beginning, it's going to cost you a lot, but for a long-term value, a PC is much better for various reasons. For one, you don't have to pay a monthly or yearly membership for online. The second thing is Steam sales, which could bring the price of your favorite game down by a lot if you're patient. And finally, if you have to upgrade after 4 years or so, instead of just replacing the whole rig like with consoles, you would just have to replace one part of it. Anyways, I hope this video was helpful. What video do you want me to do next? Let me know in the comments below and feel free to subscribe. Thanks for watching.